Hello everyone, I'm Parinder Kaur. In this video, we will be discussing about texture profile analysis. So we will be looking at how basically texture profile analysis is done using a texture profile analyzer and what are the various properties that we can determine using this equipment. So first of all, an introduction to what exactly texture is. So texture, we can basically say that texture describes what we experience when we are consuming the food product in our mouth, right? So what kind of a feel a material is giving in the mouth, whether it is very sticky, right? Whether it is sticking too much to the mouth or it is a very hard food material such as a hard boiled candies, etc., right? So what are all those properties, all those attributes which we can feel in the mouth? So for example, while eating, we can experience the initial mouth feel of the food product, hardness, adhesiveness, cohesiveness, springiness, resilience, gumminess and chewiness. All of these are the attributes of the food product which we feel in the mouth, and all of these together are responsible for giving the textures to the food product. So it is measured by a texture profile analyzer. So to determine all of these properties, we can use an equipment known as a texture profile analyzer, and we will be discussing how basically this equipment works and what are the various properties we can calculate. So texture profile analysis, how basically it works? It is a double compression test for determining the texture properties of food. So when we say double compression test, we are compressing the food material twice in order to determine its texture. So this also finds a use in certain other industries other than the food, pharmaceutical gel or certain personal care industries, all of these for the production of certain products, they are also utilizing this. What basically is happening, a bite-sized food material, 1 cm³. So mainly the food material that we are taking generally has a size of around 1 cm³. This kind of a food material we are placing in the equipment, and we are going to compress the food material. We are going to press the food material twice. Why we are compressing the food material twice? See, the motive of compressing the food material twice is we want to mimic the chewing action of the teeth. So in order to mimic the action which is caused during the chewing of the food, we do this. As a result, it is also called as a two-bite test. And the main advantage of using a texture profile analyzer is that it can quantify multiple textural parameters in just one experiment. So we can find out a number of parameters in one experiment. So what basically we mean here, if you look here, is it is a, as we said, it is a, you can call it as a two-bite test or a double compression kind of a test. See, this picture is basically a representation of what is being done. If we see over here, a food material is being kept and it is being compressed, right? So this is the original height of the food material before any compression has been provided. So what will happen is, in a texture analyzer, we had seen the equipment in the beginning. In that equipment, we will be keeping the food material, and we will be, with the help of a probe, we will be placing certain compression on the food material. So once we compress the food material, the food material's height will somewhat reduce, right? And then we remove the force back and the food retains back some of the height, right? It, whatever level it has compressed to, it is retaining back some of the height, but we can see that it has retained only this much of height. It has not come back to its original height, right? So some compression is there in the food, and then we are going to mimic the action of the teeth. We are going to compress it, but this compression will be twice. So what we have seen over here is the first compression. Now this compressor, with the help of which we provided the compression, this will be removed, and after this we will give it a some waiting time. So we can give some wait time over here, and after this wait time we will go for a second compression. So the original height of the food has already been reduced somewhat now when we are giving the second compression, right? So after giving the second compression, the food compresses again to a certain level, and again it bounces back to a certain height, which may or may not necessarily be the same, right? Some compression might even be added in the second compression. So like this, we are compressing the food material twice. Similarly, once we are biting the food, we continuously chew on the food, right? Similarly, to mimic that kind of a same action, the texture profile analyzer compresses the food material twice to mimic bite one, bite two. We can call it as a compression one, compression two, or bite one, bite two. So now how we are basically reading the readings which we are getting from the texture profile analysis. See, we are going to compress the food material twice, right? So we are going to obtain a graph between the force and the time, which is going to look something like this. What eventually is going to happen? If we are compressing the food material, right? So we are compressing the food material, and then once we remove the compression, the graph will go down. And then for the second, once we do the second compression again, once we are compressing the food material, and once we leave and start to pull back, again the graph will go down. So these kind of two peaks will be obtained, which we can see over here. So here is the first compression. So in the first compression, here we have a point F naught. We will be looking at what all of these points are. Then, so as we see, the path that the food material is following, once we are applying the force, then basically it is going to the negative side it is going, and this area gives us the adhesiveness. So we will be discussing all of this in detail. And then now the first compression has been over, right? So after the probe has been removed, we are going for the second compression, and in the second compression again we are going to obtain a graph like this. So this is how basically the graph will be. So as you see over here, you can call it as the first compression, once we are compressing, right? So once we have the food material, the plunger is going inside the food material, will give us the first compression, and once we are removing it back, will give us the first withdrawal. This particular line is coming when it is being withdrawn, and then we are giving certain waiting time over here, right? So after a waiting time, we will go for a second compression, and again we will see another peak over here. And as we observe, the first peak is always greater than the second peak. The reason being is, once we have provided the first compression to the food material, the food has already lost some of its compressibility, right? So the second time, the same amount of force will not be required to compress the food material, because already some compression has been provided during the first compression period. So we can call it as a compression withdrawal, second compression, second withdrawal, and in between we have a certain waiting time over here. So basically the texture profile analyzer is giving us a plot between the force that has been utilized to cause that compression or puncture, whatever we are calculating in the food material, with respect to the time. So now, looking at all the properties which we can calculate using a TPA one by one. So the first property we are looking over here is the fracturability. So we can define fracturability basically as the first significant peak in the first compression. That is, if we see the graph over here, we are seeing the first significant peak, not the maximum peak. If we go to the maximum, this will be hardness. The first peak where we are observing a small change over here, this value, this F naught value, is going to give us the fracturability. So we are not, see, in the first compression cycle, we are observing the first peak that we have observed, not the first maximum peak. The maximum peak is a different value, and it will give us the value of hardness. So fracturability is the first peak in the first compression, and we can say that basically the force required to produce the first significant break in the curve on the first bite, right? So initially, in the first bite over here, that is the first bite, if we see in the first bite, the initial break that is produced in the food material over here, that is giving us the value of the fracturability. So by looking at the TPA graph, the point in the first peak before the maximum intensity, where we have a small break kind of a thing, that can be calculated as a fracturability. Looking at next, we have hardness. So what do we basically mean by hardness? Hardness is the value of the peak force of the first compression. So just here, if we say hardness is the maximum peak force, so in this TPA graph, we can clearly indicate that the maximum peak point that it has reached during the first bite, right? So now, in the first bite, the maximum point that it has reached will give us the value of hardness. So this is how basically fracturability and hardness are differing. Hardness is giving the maximum peak, how much the maximum peak is coming, that is the hardness. And here, once we are just initially having certain small break, that is the fracturability. So hardness is the value of the peak force that we have seen in the first compression. The value of the peak force is the hardness, and the force exhibited in the first bite at the maximum compression, or we can say that whatever force has been exhibited in the maximum compression, right? Maximum compression, how much a food material is able to withstand, that is the hardness value. So if we relate hardness, basically we can say that hardness of food products such as bread will be less than hardness of food product such as hard boiled candies, right? So this is how, so basically if we will look at the TPA graphs of both of these products, so maybe if you look at the TPA graph, maybe the bread will have a value like this, but maybe on the other hand, something like hard boiled candies may be having a graph which will be going like this, right? So hardness will be more in case of a very hard product such as a hard boiled candies. So we will be getting a higher peak. So how we will be checking the hardness value? By looking at the TPA graph in the first bite, we will be looking at the maximum peak point that we have got. That particular point here, that particular force value will give us the value of the hardness. This is how we can basically calculate the hardness. So now coming on to the second property that we will be looking at is the cohesiveness. So now cohesiveness refers to the intermolecular forces that bind similar molecules. So basically we will be looking at cohesiveness, and simultaneously we will be understanding another term, that is adhesiveness. So what basically cohesiveness and adhesiveness mean and how they are different from one another? If we see this diagram, we see there is a test tube we have, and in the test tube there is a presence of water, right? So the water, because the water is present, there will be so much of water molecules over here, right? So the water molecules, whatever forces they are exerting with respect to each other, that is known as cohesive forces. So as we see in the diagram here, we have, these are all water molecules, right? H2O has been represented over here. So these forces which are acting between the water molecules, they are all cohesive forces, whereas the force which is acting between the water molecules and the side of the container or the side of the test tube, so these forces that will be present over here between the wall of the test tube and the water molecules is the adhesive forces. So basically we can differentiate over here that cohesive forces are the forces, we can say they are the intermolecular forces, and adhesiveness on the other hand, we can say that it is the intramolecular forces. So when the same material, the forces which is present between the same kind of molecules are acting among one another, that is the cohesive forces. Whereas if we see the water molecules with the, what kind of forces they are acting with the wall of the container, that is a different kind of a molecule, it will be called as adhesive forces. So cohesive forces refers to intermolecular forces that bind similar molecules, right? We are seeing what is the binding between, what are the forces between the water molecules with respect to the water molecules. So basically how we are going to calculate it in this, how we will be calculating the cohesiveness in the TPA. Ratio of the positive force areas under the first and the second compression, A2 by A1. So if we look at it basically, so area 2 by area 1. So ratio of the positive forces, right? So what are the positive forces? See, these are all the positive forces that we are getting, and this is what we call as a negative force. So the first positive force area under the first and the second compression, A2 by A1. So it is being given by the ratio of this A2, all this area over here with respect to this A1, area 1. So A2 by A1 will give us the cohesiveness value. See, once we are saying that cohesiveness is basically the molecules, for how they are acting with respect to one another, right? So once we have compressed the food material once, and then we have compressed the food material twice, so this will give us the compression, how the forces are acting among each other, that will give us an idea of the area 2 with respect to the area 1. So now the second property we will be looking at is the adhesiveness. So as we have already understood what is the difference between the adhesiveness and the cohesiveness, this diagram is also giving a similar explanation. So similar kind of molecules, if we have over here, they are acting, these are the adhesive forces and these are the cohesive forces. So blue color forces, because they are similar kind of molecules, the forces that are present between them are the cohesive forces, whereas If different kind of molecule is present over here, the forces which are acting between them, two different kind of molecules, are the adhesive forces. So these are giving us the adhesive forces. So adhesive forces basically are the intramolecular forces. So we can say they are the intramolecular attractions. So they are the attractive forces between different types of molecules, right? When different kind of molecules are present, A and certain B, what are the forces being produced between them is giving us the value of the adhesiveness. The forces necessary. So how we can define adhesiveness with respect to a TPA now? See, when we are saying adhesiveness is how, cohesiveness, in case of cohesiveness, how the food material, basically the molecules are behaving with one another, right? So if the molecules of the food have a lot of cohesive forces, the food will be somewhat more on the gummy side, right? It will be very, very difficult to chew a very cohesive kind of a food product. But when we say adhesive, how that property will have an effect once we are consuming the food product? When we say different kinds of, we are saying different, it is the force, utilizing forces between different molecules. So when we are consuming the food material, the food, how it is sticking to the teeth, right? The food having an interaction with other molecules of food is cohesiveness, but how the food sticks to the teeth will be the adhesiveness. So how we can calculate it on a TPA, basically, what are the forces that is necessary to remove the material that adheres to the mouth, right? How it is sticking to the mouth or to the teeth? Or in case of the TPA, how it is sticking to the equipment. So if we look over here in the TPA graph, basically, see, once we are compressing the food material, now what has happened? The food material is present over here and the plunger has gone inside the food material. Let's say we are performing a puncture test in case of an apple. So the plunger, the pointed head, we are using a pointed kind of a plunger in this case that has gone inside the apple and it has punctured it. Now it will be coming back. Once it is coming back, this curve is being produced, right? Now the plunger will need certain amount of energy to remove itself from the food material, because there will be some stickiness, there will be some adherence of the food, of the equipment, of this particular probe with the food, right? So once it is trying to remove that, we are getting this A3, this negative area graph is being obtained over here, that is the area 3, and this area 3 will give us the value of the adhesiveness. So why basically this is giving us the value of the adhesiveness? Because the plunger is being removed in this case, and the energy, because it basically it refers to different forces between different kinds of molecules, right? So the sticking of the molecules of the food to this particular equipment, right? To the equipment, once the, what is the force that is required to remove that is giving us the adhesiveness value. So we are obtaining a negative graph over here, that is the area 3. So it is given by the negative area after the first compression. Why is this negative area giving us this graph? Because what is the work required to pull away the plunger from the sample, right? We have to pull this plunger away from the sample. Adhesive forces will be created between the food material, molecules of the food, and the molecules of the plunger or the equipment, we can say. So both of these molecules are different, so adhesive forces are created. So what work is being done to pull away this plunger? That work will be coming as an area 3 after the first, after the food material is almost descended completely, right? Or we can say this plunger, basically it is, while going, first it came in, right? While going back, once the plunger has reached at this point, so how much work the plunger or the equipment has to do at this point to remove these adhering forces between the food and the equipment, that will give us this negative area or adhesiveness value. Looking at the next property we are discussing is the springiness. So springiness again is a product physically springs back. How a product bounces back to its original dimension, right? So after being deformed, after the first compression, how basically we are looking at the how basically the food springs back after it has been deformed, that will give us the springiness value, right? So if we say the food has springiness, meaning the food bounces back, tries to bounce back to its original dimension, right? So if we have compressed the food material, if we have cause compression in the food material, and once we lift this food, so during the compression, maybe the food material may be becoming like this, it was losing some of its height. But once we remove the plunger, what is the probability of this food coming exactly back to its original height, right? So how basically we can calculate the springiness? If we look at the ratio of the two heights, right, caused during the second compression and during the first compression, that can give us the springiness value very easily. So ratio or percentage of the product's recovery to its original height, right? So basically it is just the ratio, that the ratio the product is coming back to its original height. So how we can calculate it? Distance 2 by distance 1 into 100. What is distance 2 and distance 1? We will be looking at the TPA graph, or we can also say time 2 by time 1 into 100. Both of these ways springiness can be calculated. If we want to take it in terms of percentage, we can multiply by 100. Otherwise, simply the ratio can be taken, distance 2 by distance 1. So what is basically this distance 2 by distance 1? If we look on the graph over here, this is the time 2 by time 1, or distance 2 by distance 1. How much time is being taken? This T2, then this T1, or we can take the distance 2 and the distance 1. They can also be taken. So distance 2 by distance 1 or time 2 by time 1, both of these will give us the springiness value. Why basically this is giving us the springiness value? How much we have to compress the food material over here and how much we have to compress the food material over here. If the food material is quite springy, this value should be very much equal to this value, because the food is coming back to its original height, right? So this should not differ much from this in case of a food material which is very, very springy in nature. So coming back to this, basically, so distance 2 by distance 1 into 100, or we can say time 2 by time 1 into 100. If we want to take it in percentage, if we want to consider it in percentage, we can multiply by 100. If springiness is high, it requires more mastication energy in the mouth, right? So if the food is very, very springy, more of the mastication energy will be required in the mouth while chewing of the food product. So the next property we are discussing is the gumminess. So along with gumminess, we are going to discuss one more property, that is chewiness. So gumminess and chewiness. So gumminess is the energy required to disintegrate a semi-solid food material until it is ready for swallowing. Okay, so whatever energy is required to break a particular food material in the mouth, a semi-solid food material, this word is very, very important over here. How much energy is required to break a semi-solid food material until it is ready to swallow? That is going to give us the gumminess value. Whereas chewiness is the energy required to disintegrate a solid food until it is ready for swallowing. So that is basically the difference between the two. In gumminess, we are calculating how much energy is required to chew a semi-solid food before it is ready for swallowing. And in case of chewiness, we are calculating the energy required to break a solid food before it is ready for swallowing. That is the basic difference between the two. So gumminess is mutually exclusive with chewiness. The reason being is both of these cannot exist at the same time, because if a product is semi-solid, the same product cannot be solid, right? So either a product can be classified as a solid or a semi-solid. So if we are talking about a solid food product, the property that we will be discussing about will be chewiness, and if we are discussing about a semi-solid food product, the property we will discuss will be gumminess. So how gumminess can be calculated? It can be calculated by hardness into cohesiveness, right? If you are able to relate hardness, maximum peak, how much hard the food material is, and how cohesive, how much is the stickiness, we can say, or the adherence of the intermolecular forces between the food molecules, right? So both of these ones multiplied, they will give us the value of the gumminess. On the other hand, the cohesiveness will be the energy required to chew a solid until it is ready for swallowing, and this value can be calculated by hardness into cohesiveness into springiness. So this gumminess value, we were calculating hardness into the cohesiveness, but for calculation of chewiness, another property is being added, hardness into cohesiveness into springiness. So as we have just looked, that hardness into cohesiveness is basically the gumminess, right? Gumminess is calculated as hardness into cohesiveness. So we can also write this formula as gumminess into springiness. So to calculate chewiness, we can either be calculated as gumminess into the springiness, or we can say hardness into cohesiveness into springiness. Since hardness into cohesiveness is equal to gumminess, that is why we can also write gumminess into springiness. So for example, when we say solid food products, what are the food products that can be for which we will be calculating properties such as chewiness? We can calculate it for food products such as chapatis, right? Or we can look at the food products such as biscuits and all, which are completely solid and they're not in a semi-solid kind of a state. For calculating the properties of such kind of food products, we go for the term chewiness rather than the term gumminess. Resilience is basically a measurement of how the sample fights to regain its original height. So once we have compressed the food material, with what frequency, or we can say how much it is trying, it has the ability to regain its original height. So it should not be confused with springiness, because in springiness we are taking the distance 2 or the time 2 by the time 1. Whereas here we are going to calculate area 5 divided by area 4. This will give us the resilience value. So once we have compressed the food material and once we have removed the plunger, once the plunger is going away from the food material, so what value, basically this divided by this, so area 5, so this particular area 5 divided by the area 4, right? So how much the material is trying to, so area 5 by area 4, how much the material, the measurement of how the sample fights to regain back its original height, right? So how much it has been trying to regain the original height. So this will give us an idea of that. That is basically giving us the resilience value. So ratio of the first up compression. So we can say that it is the ratio of the first up decompression, right? So this decompression which is being caused with respect to the compression which has been caused. So it is the ratio of this, see, because the plunger is being removed over here, right? So once we have removed it from the food material, we are obtaining this peak over here. So the value of the, so we can say the ratio of the decompression, because once the probe or the plunger is removed from the food material, we are having a decompression value, and then with to a ratio of what was the compression caused. So we can say that during the first bite cycle, all of these is being calculated in the first bite cycle, right? So this is the first bite or the first compression, we can say. So what is the value, what is the ratio of the first decompression to the first compression? So ratio of the first up the decompression, that is up when the material, when the probe is going up, the decompression is caused with respect to the first down. Once the compression is being caused, the probe is coming down. So basically area 5 by area 4. So this area with respect to this area can give us the value of the resilience. With this, I end this topic, and I hope that this topic was clear to you. Thank you.